Hi, I am Sezal and I have been learning Clojure at Nilenso for about 6 months now. I was new to functional programming, Lisp, when I started learning Clojure and have mostly worked in Python and C++, as he mentioned. So with that perspective, I want to talk about some issues which I struggled with while learning Clojure, and I'm still struggling with some of them today. These are the topics I will talk about. All of you who are trying to learn Clojure, you will run across these issues. At that point, I want you to remember this talk, realize that you will trip up here, and look up the suggestions I've made, or just read about it a bit more. More of you will be mentoring in Clojure, so highlight these issues to the new people and mention how you tackle them. Let's start. First up is parentheses, obviously. This is Clojure we're talking about. Nobody wants to count these parentheses to see if they match. It's too big of a task. This syntax should not be tripping you up. We need to install Clojure dev environments and make our lives easier. It won't even let you add unmatching brackets. Also, learn about structural editing from the beginning. In this, you are not editing characters, but you're editing pieces or blocks of the whole abstract syntax tree. Moving smaller expressions up and down this tree will make you realize the true power of Lisp. Paradid, slurp, barf, all pieces of structural editing are available in every single Clojure tooling. Debugging. So first things first, REPL is great, use it. I think everybody knows it here, but the beginners really need to focus on it. I love the REPL. I run almost every line I write almost simultaneously in the REPL. It's instantaneous feedback. All of you should definitely be doing this. But still, sometimes I had trouble debugging in Clojure. And this was because from my Python background, I was always writing print statements wherever I wanted. Not saying good or bad, but I was just doing that. But this kind of print debugging is a bit trickier in Clojure because your every expression is part of a chain, and inserting a print statement breaks that chain. So I have two examples here. In both of these cases, writing a print in the if function, inside the if function, as well as inserting the print in the macro, in the thread macro, is basically nullifying the whole thing. It's not what you want to do. So this debug function is a very basic function you can have in your utilities, which will make the thing correct. And there are many, many variations available of this particular function. One of them I have linked in this slide. You should definitely look it up. There are many other libraries which help you do this kind of print debugging, HashP, LogSpy, etc. Apart from this, there are tools available in Cider, very good tools for tracing your functions, for adding breakpoints, etc. Whatever your flavor of debugging is, you can find something. Next up is for. So this I took a while to understand, but the for loops you are used to from whatever language you're coming from, they don't really exist in Clojure, at least not the ones in Python, C++, whatever. So in Clojure, it's actually a list comprehension. So what you can see in this mathematical expression, what you can express like this, is what you can do with Clojure. So if your first instinct is to write a for loop in Clojure, don't do it, not at all. Check if you can use map or filter instead. In 99% of the cases, that's going to work out better. When you want to call a bunch of side effects for a sequence, use do sequence. I believe Ramcharan already mentioned that. If you're trying to modify a value within a for, use loop or recur or reduce. And similar if you're trying to change, trying to break or continue a loop, which you kind of do in C++ or Python, based on some changing value. Always loop, recur, or reduce. What you should use for is when you're working with multiple sequences or dimensions. That works out really well as compared to other functions available. So, reiterating on the previous talk, lazy sequences. Ramshan talked about it. I think other people have also mentioned that it's an important thing. For me, the most important thing while working with lazy sequences is to be aware that the expression is producing a lazy sequence. So if you took the help shift quiz and there was like being burnt by lazy sequences, I'm also part of it. So let's look at this example. I have a slow function here, which takes about a second to increment a number. I wanted to time it, and it took about a second, which makes sense. But when I use the same function in a map, it seemed to take no time at all. So what just happened here? This map expression was read, but it was not evaluated. Maybe it will be evaluated later, but if you are using this time as a metric for something, it has totally failed. So you need to be aware that you are using some function or macro which results in a lazy sequence. You can safely only use them in 100% pure functions. So my one advice would be, do not mix lazy sequences and side effects unknowingly. Lack of examples. The first pointer towards this is the number of posts on Stack Overflow based on language. You can see a stark difference between these four. I think it's an unpopular opinion in this community, but I think these numbers are really bad. Almost, and it's not just this, it's an overall lack of open source code. If I'm searching, I'm only finding open source libraries. It's impossible to find a fully fledged open source CRUD app. I started learning Clojure at Nilenso, where everybody knew Clojure, and still I had some trouble because of this lack of examples. Imagine anybody trying to learn who doesn't have access to that ecosystem. I remember when I was trying to use the Mount library, I just wanted some example, two, three examples to know how to use it, what it's doing. And I did not find it. Even the documentation was talking about Mount versus component before talking about Mount itself. So it's just hard to understand when you don't have the context. It's hard to read the source code and understand. Well, you still, you don't have that much context. So it's hard for a beginner. So I would ask the full community to dig more into, whatever they have done, put some open source code available for other people to look at, ask and answer more questions. I think that's something we can do. So magic versus no magic. Again, going back to Python, I was building a Python Django application before starting at Nilenso. It was very easy to create a fully functional application database using the ORM available in Django. It abstracted out the creation of tables, migrations, pretty much everything. Total magic was happening. So let's compare how I can add a table in Django versus Clojure. So in Django, I write the model for a new table, and then I say migrate. In Clojure, I have to write SQL migrations for the table. I have to add the migration function using ragtime library. I have to migrate, and then I have to write the CRUD functions for the table using JDBC. So while in Django, I was able to make that application with the minimal knowledge of SQL. I mean, I'm not saying that there are no frameworks in Clojure which would allow you to do this, but most of the community prefers a bottom-up approach on building things. And this contrast here between Clojure and other languages or frameworks makes things difficult. To do anything, you need to learn 10 more things. But I also want to make the point that this contrast is what makes Clojure worth it. To do, like the DB example, there are multiple other services which work similarly in Clojure. So this will force you to learn the surrounding ecosystem you're functioning in, and that will make you a better programmer. You will make better decisions if you know what you're deciding about. Other languages might, allow you to not even think about the underlying layers, but here you need to know, and it makes you better. In the previous slide, the lack of examples. Again, when you go around digging into the source code of different libraries, you will learn exponentially. Finally, why? I don't know why this exists. I don't want to be changing from snake kebab, snake case to kebab case and vice versa. It doesn't make any sense. So Clojure influencers, please say that the snake case is okay and I can just stop doing this. Someone already saying no, come on. That's it. Thank you.